50-50 distinction between commercial banks and other financial institutions, and why do I make that distinction? Partly maybe it's pragmatic because commercial banks have been protected for decades in the United States, protected in other countries. They have access to this so-called safety net. They can borrow from the Federal Reserve. They can deal with their liquidity problems. They have deposit insurance. They get friendly advice now and again from their regulators, and they have regulators that have the authority to regulate very intensively. Now, that's not an accident. This is true all over the world for decades, because there is a perception that commercial bank stability is essential to the operation of financial markets. It may account for a smaller proportion of finance in the United States than it used to, but it's still got critical functions. Nobody else runs the payment system, whether it's going to your neighborhood bank or your neighborhood teller machine, or whether it's sending complicated payments all over the world on several seconds' notice. It's an essential function in the global economy. Who else is lending to small businesses and medium-sized businesses? Who else is backing up the commercial paper market? Who else is providing a depository that people have some conviction about in its liquidity and availability of par? It was quite evident during this past crisis, you did not get a run by and large on commercial bank deposits. It is an essential function, essential element of stability in the financial system. Say nothing about the fact that commercial banks are the central vehicle through which monetary policy operates. So I don't make any excuses for saying that central banks are a special institution that, deserving or not, it's not a moral issue, whether have a compelling need for substantial government protection on the one side and very substantial government intrusion and regulation on the other side. Now, what's the implication of that? The implication to me is that commercial banks should be paying attention to their knitting, paying attention to these essential functions, and not be out running a casino on the side. A casino protected by government support, because that is very meaningful in terms of its availability of finance, availability to rates upon which they pay for their liabilities and all the rest. And there's a great big market out there elsewhere. What's left of the commercial banks, hedge funds, equity funds, ready, willing, able to trade, they love it, it's fine, let them go. But if they fail, they should fail. They should know that they're not going to get the protection of the official safety net. Now, that is a crucial point to be made, either a strong point, I suppose, or a weak point, depending on how you look at it. But to make that view credible, you've got to answer the question of what happens when they do fail, particularly for those few institutions, and there are very few non-bank institutions, in my view, that are truly systemic importance. What happens if they are failing? Well, that's where this idea of a special resolution authority comes in. You get a new agency, or you get an existing agency, and Dodd-Bill, it's the FDIC, that can step in, take over that failing institution in a matter of hours or days or a weekend, take control of the institution, satisfy any immediate liquidity problem that may exist. I would have to have access to some money, but essentially take it over for the purposes of burying it, providing a, technically a liquidation, let me call it a decent burial, but it will be buried. It might be a breakup, you might chop off an arm and a leg and sell it to somebody. Maybe you can use some of the organs to support some other institution as we do in the medical field. But basically, that institution will disappear. Stockholders will be gone, its management will be gone, its creditors will be at risk to the extent that the assets of the institution in the marketplace are not worth their liabilities. And the government will be protected if they have to provide any money at all. So that is a distinction, and can it be made credible? Well, my simple notion is, if we want to get back to this thing that's been called the Volcker Rule, much to my surprise, I want to maintain that distinction between commercial banks and other financial institutions. I maintain that distinction. I can't have commercial banks able to do the same thing that these other institutions are doing, and I particularly don't want those other institutions to have a commercial banking license, and therefore, by implication, be supported by the whole panoply of government potential and actual support. So that's what this is all about, and that's the heart of the matter so far as I am concerned, and